The rocks and the alpine valleys are integral part of this discourse. This pattern echoes that of major national museums of the 19th century. As we know, nature and landscape, which only a superficial gaze can consider neutral, have prominent parts in the Prague museums or in the frescoes of the formal entrance room of the Neues Museum in Berlin. But also new and very new museums develop along the same lines. In the new Hong Kong Museum, the rocks tell a story. They are pages in Hong Kong history. They have been put on display with the aim of defining the nation and its long-standing existence in existence as long as geological eras. The discourse is complex. In several cases, the landscape has in fact constituted a strongly distinctive feature of memory and the national identity, as clearly shown in regard to the rural Douce France by Nora's Lieu de Mémoire. The landscape has also been one of the essential elements of the literary canon in many countries, and perhaps in all of them. It has certainly played a central role in poetry, novels, and song, and in Italy we have learned for generations a famous passage from Alessandro Manzoni's national novel, I Promessi Sposi, which the living, where the living of the native land is marked by a melancholy gaze which surveys the feature of a well-known landscape. The scene at dock is obvious. The landscape, narrated, is the Italian one of the Bel Paese that formed the title of a famous 19th century school book. And the image of an Italy whose boundaries are marked by the Alps and include Trentino and Istria and Dalmatia as well, have constituted a geographical topos of great usefulness for irredentism and nationalism. The same applies to France. Bruno's Tour de France par des enfants also significantly included the lost Alsace. The nation's landscape is a powerful theme. It is also reflected in landscape paintings. Now, the powerful interconnections of landscape and memory on the one hand and the geographical and geological image of the nation on the other have nurtured and supported different kinds of nationalism. An extreme case, one which I would label geological nationalism, is a film shown in the first room of the newly reopened Museum of Scotland, which informs the visitors that millions of years ago, Scotland and England were indeed not part of the same continent. In face of the challenges of the present, however, it seems necessary to reverse this discourse and to resume the theme of nature and the environment in National Museum from a completely point of view, which, as far as I know, is almost entirely ignored by national historical museums. This does not solely concern the category of the intangible heritage, and perhaps the word intangible heritage, nor celebration of the beauties of the landscape as ironic elements, heritage of the national culture of the humanity. The transformations of nature and the rural landscape by the national states has been one of the key components of their policies. The impact of the industrialization on the landscape has been equally decisive, and these two should be one of the central elements of national history on which to reflect. But today, the challenge raised by the great questions of environmental history is much more radical. In face of the rethinking of energy policies, in face of the issues of nuclear power and water and the protection of nature, that may bring catastrophes only in part natural and in reality often pre-announced, it seems necessary to consider the history of the nation state also from this point of view. Thus, the rocks and the soils, the rivers and the mountains, will identify not political frontiers to defend with weapons, but another frontier to be addressed with responsible tools of science. As the key element of ethno-nationalism, no longer the burden, But the environment may become a crucial aspect of profound reflection on the country's history, which concerns all those who live in it. I have greatly appreciated the distinction drawn by several scholars between a blind nationalism characterized by unquestioning staunch allegiance and intolerance of criticism, and the more fruitful constructive patriotism positively associated with multiple indicators of political involvement. Rethinking environmental politics in history museums might perhaps give rise to a less blind and more constructive patriotism. Thank you.